previous part, we talked about the miasms and how they came about by Hahnemann in historical context, and then how I made a big jump to Sankaran, how we changed the way we understood miasms, the definition of the miasms, and understood them as a classification of delusions. And then he added a few miasms to the already known ones. We had five, he added acute, which was six, and then four more intermediate miasms, which makes our chart of 10 miasms. And with all the keywords that I gave you in a quick overview. So this is important because in plant cases, almost always they display their miasm very clear, even to the extent that by the context, this was the first part of the previous session, that the context that will point you or make you think about the plant case, and the fact that the miasm is clear even before you have a sensation, that your mind already goes right from the beginning of the anamnesis to a plant remedy, and for instance, psychotic. Now, let's say you know already in the first 15 or 20 minutes of your interview that you need a plant from the psychotic miasm or from the leprosy miasm. Your choice of remedies is much more limited and your anamnesis will be more focused. So that is, I see, as a very big advantage. Next question, of course, is how do we know which remedy belongs to which miasm? Well, fortunately, we have those charts now. Sankaran started to list all those remedies of a particular plant family that he examined and did a computer search, as I told you, and by the symptoms, very often physical symptoms, he was able to put a particular remedy in a particular box of a miasm. So we have this very, very helpful charts where the sensation and the miasm is crossed, and there in those boxes we find the remedies we need. In practice, this means, for instance, we know that we need a remedy from the poppy family. We think, of course, about opium, but the miasm doesn't fit because the patient is not from the psychotic or the cancer miasm. It's much more to the acute or the typhoid, so we know we need one of those remedies. It would be hard without the chart to come up with a remedy, but in the chart you will see in the acute there's morphine, in the typhoid miasm there's arachimonium. So what do you do then? Either the miasm is very clear and you can make a choice, or you go to Materia Medica and you will have a look which remedy fits your patient best. And then you will be surprised very often how well these remedies fit, how well the symptoms listed in your books, even if it's a limited picture, how well the symptoms fit your patient. And then you can prescribe with certainty that you have the good remedy. So these charts are very helpful. It's very helpful to know how they came about. And it's also good to know that they are not complete yet. So there's still a lot of work to do. A lot of those boxes are still empty. It's a work in progress. A lot of families are not in the chart yet. Maybe there are boxes where there's a remedy that is not quite in its place and it needs to be moved a little bit to the left or the right. Maybe it's in ringworm and it should be in psychosis, psychotic miasm. Well, future will tell. And of course, sometimes there's only one remedy in a box and maybe we'll need two, three, four or five of the same family, because they all belong to the same miasm and we are able to even differentiate more. And if you go to your charts, you will see that, for instance, in the compositae family we talked about last time, in certain boxes there are even three or four remedies. In the Lilia flora we have boxes with four or five remedies. But be honest, only four or five remedies to differentiate makes our life a lot easier, doesn't it? Now, where does all this knowledge take us? We're going to study another group of plant families. I told you we can group them a little bit to make it easier to remember them. Last time we grouped three families in a bigger group and we called them the pain families. I told you we have the attach-detach a group if you want, which contains the Scrofulariaceae, the Malvalis and the Euphorbiaceae. We have the amusement boredom group containing the Rubiaceae, Piperaceae and Labiatae. And today we're going to talk about the stuck group. The stuck group containing the Crucifera, the Anacardiaceae and the Primulaceae. For instance, let us take the Anacardiaceae, because that's a well-known family, at least it has a very well-known member, and that is Rustox. Rustox is a family member of this group in the typhoid miasm. Because we know the remedy well and it has many, many symptoms, we know, for instance, it is a remedy for strains and for stiffness and rheumatic joints and starting problems. You know, we say that it rusts when he stays sit, then he has the feeling he rusts and he has difficulty in the beginning of movement. As he warms up, it gets better, and when he has continuous motion, then it's worse again because exertion aggravates his problem. We know the remedy is affected by cold and wet. He's very sensitive to cold and wet weather, and it is the first remedy you think about when somebody has a sprained ankle or a sprained wrist or something. This is what we know in general. There are many, many more characteristics of Rustox. It's very restless, he's always moving, because he feels if he doesn't move, then everything gets stiff. And that's the main sensation of the whole family, this feeling of stiffness, this feeling of tightness, this feeling of being stuck, because it's a stuck family. Like, stuck means if you don't move, you cannot move anymore. You got stuck in a certain place, you got stuck in your body, you get caught, as if you feel tension, and it is mind and body. The same feeling, the same sensation will come up if they tell you about things that happened in their life. They have a problem, and the problem makes them feel stuck, or makes them feel tight, or they cannot move. They want to move and they can't. They feel stiff. The condition to be okay is always on the move, always restless, moving with something or moving with everything. They want to be on the move because they feel sitting aggravates. Being still, not moving, aggravates. Motion ameliorates. Modalities we know from the stocks, but applying to the whole family. And they're worse in the house. They want to go out. We know that. They want to move and they want to go out. And motion in general is better. Now, if a person tells you, a patient tells you all these things, this feeling caught and stuck and stiff in mind and body, first idea could be, let's give him Rustox. But if he isn't a typhoid personality, typhoid, you remember, is this stiffness, this feeling of being caught and stiff and stuck, is like a crisis. I have to do something quickly. I have to do it now. If I don't solve this problem now, I will never be able to. Or this could be the end. This is the feeling. It's a threat. It's a threat that with a fatal outcome. That's typhoid miasm. It's a life-threatening situation. And you have to do something now. There's an urgency. And that's why they will ask for help, demand for help, shriek for help, make you help them now. If you have all those sensation words, but you don't have this coping up mechanism, then obviously you need another miasm. If your patient said, oh, well, yeah, it is a stiff and tight feeling. As one gets older, maybe I should resign and live with it. Or if the patient said, well, I avoid sitting still for a long time because I know then I will feel stiff and I will have this stuck feeling, makes me very uncomfortable. So I avoid to be in this situation, and I always find a reason to move about, or I always find an excuse, to go from my desk and go for some something I have to do at the photocopy machine or whatever they find, to be always in constant motion. That is avoiding the problem and by doing something or denying it. I'm always move because otherwise I'm not stiff, but I just like to move. And in this denial, you can recognize the psychotic miasm. Now, which is the remedy of the Anacardiaceae family of the psychotic miasm? How to know? Well, then we have the charts. And as I told you, they make our life much easier. You go into your chart and you see Omangifera. Isn't that the mango? Yeah, that's the mango tree. So you don't know the remedy very well. You might not even know it at all. Maybe you never heard of it, but that's no problem, because sensation is clear, miasm is clear, and the remedy is there in the box, and you can give it with full certainty. And I can assure you, if your sensation and your miasm is right in your patient, the remedy will do the trick. It is the Simulamin, and it's confirmed over and over and over again. Although this is a work in progress, it doesn't mean that by this time already we don't have many remedies cases. We do have confirmation, because many people work with that system and these theories, and many cases confirm already that the theory is solid. I do have Mangifera cases who work beautifully, and not only those, but we can prescribe all the remedies in the charts with 10 miasms. So we have Risvenenata, always considered as a small remedy, but no, we can prescribe it now if the miasm fits. Risglabra of the leprosy miasm, would you ever think of it? Otherwise, it's a small remedy. We know Anacardium, of course. Anacardium is in the box of the cancer miasm, and that's another advantage. Would you before have seen the similarities between Rustox and Anacardia? But they're family members, so obviously they look alike. They have the basic, same basic sensation. They have a different way of coping with the inner feeling. And this makes them different, but they are very similar in their basic feelings. And if it's not very clear in Anacardium as a remedy, you can conclude it, you can deduct it from the general family characteristics. So it is a very big advantage, because many more remedies come to our disposition now. Not only the well-known, but also the unknown brothers and sisters in the same family. Another plant family that is more or less similar in their stuck feeling is the Primulacea. They're not very well known. Maybe the only family member we know well is Cyclamen. Cyclamen belonging to the leprosy miasm. And the other remedy, Amaryllis, is not very well known, not to say not known at all. And this remedy belongs to the syphilitic miasm. You see, they are very close, and we tend to prescribe the remedy we know, or we used to prescribe only the remedies we know. I think we can now easily change this attitude and use the other remedies, because we have enough guarantees that the theory is solid. The basic general idea of Primulacea is unable to move. You see how similar it is, but they feel more like lame, that's the word they will use, like paralyzed, like they're tired and they cannot move. And or they feel it directly and they will tell you, or indirectly they will say, I'm not the one that will lie on the couch. I'm too young to lay down half of the day. And I have a patient like that, because the problem she had was a very serious physical problem. But the main thing for her was, and she was in her 50s, but I'm too young to be on the couch all day. The doctor says I have to rest, but what does he expect me to do? That I can't go for a dance? She was a dancer. That I have to lay on the couch? I'm not a potato, I can't lay on the couch all day, I want to do things. And she was seriously ill. But this picture of laying on the couch like a lame person, like somebody who's unable to move, was sheer horror for her. This was the main thing that was unacceptable. So what they want to do is, of course, the complete opposite. Want to be in continuous motion all of the time. They want to move all of the time. They want to be active all of the time. And they want to travel, they want to see a lot of things, they want to do a lot of things. And they do it with increased strength. They have a lot of stamina, a lot of strength, and be in continuous motion. So if you have a patient that looks very Cyclamen-like, but the miasm is not really fitting. It's very close, but it's not really fitting. It's pure syphilitic. Then you can give Anagalis, probably a remedy you would never have thought about if you were not consulting your chart. Another example is the Crucifera family. The Crucifera family have the general feeling of being obstructed. Like they want to move forward and they feel blocked. You see how close it is to tight and stiff and caught, but it is blocked. It's like there's a dam, there's a barrier. They are hindered. They have a movement, and the movement can go on because something is in their way. That's how they feel. It's not like their body is stiff, but the movement they are making is obstructed. That's the feeling, it's stopped. They're doing something, they are in a movement, in a flow, and it is stopped by something or somebody. So what they want to do is not this exertion or this activity or, you know, doing something vigorously, but this free flow. Like the things have to flow, have to continue, have to move on, have to go on. That is the free flowing, and the free movement is the contrary to the obstructed movement, to the obstructed flow. You see, this is all kind of subtle, but there is a difference. And if you're not very sure, then you can ask. Because if you're doubting between Crucifera and Anacardiasis, say, then you can explain, you can ask the patient to explain a bit more. Like you feel, let's say they feel obstructed and caught, and then you think, oh my God, this is two sensations of two different families. And which one is the family they need? Then you ask, can you tell me a little bit about feeling caught and obstructed? Or tell me a bit more by obstructed. Or what do you mean by caught and obstructed? And then by the synonyms and the images. Remember, these are plants. They might give you another example where it's up to you to understand whether it's really caught because you're too stiff to move. You know, you're all rusty and you have to warm up before you have this movement in your body again or in your mind. Or you were in a particular flow and all of a sudden you were damned. And I say all of a sudden, but depending on the miasm, this can be a sensation, a feeling of a sudden thing, of a chronic thing, or a even potentially fatal thing. That is the delusional part of it, like the sensation is experienced how. The what is the sensation and the how is the miasm. And they are two aspects of the same thing. And a plant, they are not easy to separate. So we know from the Crucifera family, not too many remedies, I think. Cochlearia is one of our classic remedies. Raphanus is from the leprosy miasm. Cochlearia is from the psychotic miasm. And maybe that's about it. Those two remedies, and even them, or those are considered as small remedies. But if you have this, let's say, clear sensation of blocked and damped and barrier, and it is not psychotic miasm, and it's for sure not leprosy miasm, which is Raphanus, but it's way towards the psoriatic or the acute. Let's say the acute miasm, you're clear, it's very sure, it's all of a sudden damped, it's all of a sudden blocked, all of a sudden the barrier, and with a feeling of panic, like, if I can't go on, this can be fatal, if I can move freely, if I can move forward, it can be the end of me. This is very clear acute miasm, it is very clear Crucifera sensation, and the remedy in your charts again is Lipidium. Ever heard of Lipidium? It's not among the first 500 remedies we study, do we? Yet for your patient, if that's the similimum, it will work, I told you, as long and as deep as any Polycrest will do. Or we could prescribe Sinapis alba, Sinapis nigra, and many more remedies of this cabbage family belonging to the Crucifera we are studying now, and before we would only think about as clinical small remedies for a particular symptom when we have specific rubrics like obstructed in the nose, and then we would think about Sinapis. But not as a constitutional remedy. And all those remedies now come to our disposal, and this is mainly due to our miasm theory or our understanding of miasms in our plant patients.
In our journey through this advanced course on the vital approach, we have wandered through the animal, mineral and plant kingdom. However, at least one more mysterious domain remains to be unraveled, the dark universe of the bacteria and viruses, the Monera kingdom. To prepare for this session, you can read the books written by Lou Klein and Frans Vermeulen. Don't miss the live and video seminars, of which you'll find a schedule on Anna Verwerke's website.